About the University of Glasgow. We have Colette McGowan with us from Glasgow. She is the International Recruitment Partnerships Manager. So I will turn it over to her.
Thank you, Phoebe. Welcome everyone to this hopefully short presentation. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the University of Glasgow and also about our exchange program. It's going to give you a really high level overview of the program, but there will be opportunities after, at the end of it, to ask questions. So if you feel that there's anything that we haven't covered, then please feel free to ask more specific questions towards the end of the presentation. So to begin with, I'll tell you a little bit about Glasgow and the university. We are one of the ancient universities. So we were established way back in 1451. We are the second oldest university in the United Kingdom and the fourth oldest in the English speaking world. The university buildings that if you come to Glasgow, you will experience them. They don't actually date back to 1451 because when it was established, it was in a different location in the city of Glasgow. And we have been in our current location since around the late 1870s. Glasgow, the city, we'll talk a little bit more about that later on, but it has been voted the world's friendliest city. And as I say, I'll tell you a little bit more about that. And also the fact that we're a UNESCO City of Music. This is just telling you a little bit about where we are placed in world rankings. One of the rankings that we're most proud of is the fact that we came second in the Russell Group for student satisfaction. So we're very proud of the fact that our students are satisfied with our teaching, our learning, and our facilities. And the Russell Group, just to give you a bit of information about that, it's a group of research intensive UK universities, similar to the US Ivy League. The university is a large university by Scottish standards. I think we're the second largest in Scotland. We have around 29,000 students from all over the world, from well over 140 countries. And again, I'll tell you a little bit more about that in the context of the exchange programme. So we work currently with around 400 study abroad and exchange partners right across the world. And you'll see on this slide that we've mentioned some of the countries that we are exchanging with. So that is where we are sending students to partners in these countries, and we're also receiving students. It means that the programme that you're coming to study with us through, i.e. our exchange programme, will have students from all over the world, and you will be mixing with them, fingers crossed everything goes well and we're back to normal in a less socially distant way by the time you come and study with us. But you will mix with students from all over the world on the exchange programme. At the same time as mixing with full degree students, regular degree students at the university. So you'll be taking classes right alongside all of our degree seeking students from the UK, from Europe, and again from countries right around the world. A little bit about Scotland, the country. We are a small nation. We have just over 5 million inhabitants, and the majority of the population is located around Glasgow, which is the largest city, and right across, if you can imagine the shape of Scotland, which is it's quite small and has a sort of central area, and that's where most people will live. Further north is where you can see beautiful highlands and beautiful mountains like you see in the slide here. But the central belt is where the majority of people are based in the large cities. There are many, many outdoor activities. So if that is your thing, you only need to travel about half an hour from Glasgow, from the city, and you're out in the great outdoors. And very easy access to mountain ranges, to skiing, believe it or not, and trails and canoeing, whitewater rafting, etc. So all of those activities are right on your doorstep. But in addition to that, Glasgow and the country of Scotland has a really bustling, thriving cultural and music scene, which I'll tell you a little bit more about on the next slide. But you'll also be steeped in history. The university, as I said, was founded in 1451. So even just studying at the university, you're going to be surrounded by history and be able to see it and experience it firsthand. Glasgow, the city, I mentioned, is the largest city in Scotland. We do have a capital city, which is slightly smaller, and that is Edinburgh. And that is where the UCEAP director is based. So you will get to see Edinburgh as well during your stay, usually at the beginning of your stay in Scotland. But it's also very, very close to Glasgow. It's only about 45 minutes by train. But Glasgow, back to Glasgow, which is where the university is located, Glasgow is very different to the city of Edinburgh. It's a very friendly city. People are very down to earth. And we say, or we believe that that's because we have long-standing industrial roots and have come from being a very working class city. So people don't take themselves seriously, but what it means is that they are also very welcoming to people from all over the world. We have fantastic shopping in Glasgow. It's said to be the best place outside of London, but we also have many other activities. We really are a cafe culture, lots of restaurants, fantastic eateries to experience. And as I mentioned before, we are a UNESCO City of Music, which means that there is some type of music happening every night of the week. You'll be able to see a live performance, from going along to a pub to experience Scottish folk music, to going to one of the larger venues, like those that are featured on this slide, which are the big concert arenas. So really everything, if you're into music, you'll be able to find all different types of music to suit your needs in and around Glasgow. The university is located in the west end of the city, which is a real bustling, thriving student location. This slide shows you one of the main streets alongside the university, which is just bursting with cafes and pubs. And on a night out, the lights are all lit up and people spill out onto the street. So it's really a fantastic location to be based. And around the university there are two parks as well. So you're not right in the city centre. We're based around 3 miles from the city centre in the West End. So it's a really nice mix of urban and a little bit of rural with the parks around as well. But lots to do, lots of really boutique types of shops, vintage boutiques, cultural attractions, and there are many, many museums around the city of Glasgow, but also particularly around where the university is located, and most of them are free of charge or free entry. So now we'll move on to just telling you a little bit about the different options that you have. We'll ignore the International Summer School. I forgot to take that off of this particular slide, but we're going to talk about the exchange programme and the different options that you have to study with us. So the exchange programme allows you to come and study for either a semester or for a year, depending on the flexibility of your own course. As I mentioned earlier, you will come and study alongside regular degree students. So you're taking classes alongside students from all over the world, from Scotland as well, and from different parts of the United Kingdom. Alongside that, you will also be mixing with other students on the exchange programme. So normally in an academic year, we will have around 1,200 students who participate in the exchange programme at any given time. Highlights of our programme include the fact that your accommodation is guaranteed. So you, when you apply to the exchange programme and are accepted to that programme, you will then be asked to apply for accommodation, and the On the accommodation application, you'll be given up to 7 choices to select from. And as long as you submit your application by the deadline, which is normally August for September entry, then you'll be able to secure a place in university accommodation. Additionally, we have, in addition to the University of California orientation program, we also offer full orientation program at the University of Glasgow. Again, normally it will, in normal times, it would be very much face to face, and it usually lasts between 3 and 5 days for the September entry. And then for January entry, it's usually a 2-day orientation. But it's a very flexible programme, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. What we try to do is to allow students to mix and match courses as much as they possibly can. And one of our slides, which we'll come on to in a second, will show you the range of courses that are normally available to any of our exchange students. The programme structure, as I mentioned, you can study either for one semester or for an academic year. And our academic year has 120 credits attached to it. So if you're coming for a semester, you would be looking to take 60 of our credits, which will equate to a full load at your university. But questions about the actual ins and outs of how it transfers, those should be referred back to the EAP programme. This just gives you an idea of the real breadth of subject areas that we offer at the University of Glasgow. It's by no means a final list or a full list of all of our courses, but it just gives you a bit of an idea of the different range of courses that would be available to you to take. And as I mentioned, we try to be as flexible as possible. So we do try to allow students to take courses in different subject areas, provided that the timetables work out and obviously that you have the required knowledge in order to take those courses. But flexibility is really at the heart of our programme in order to be able to allow you to take the courses that you need for your subject back home. In terms of living expenses, this slide is a guide. So it's not the final or definite list, or the definitive list rather, of cost of living, but it's to give you a guide as to how much it would cost you. And you can see here that accommodation is by far the largest expense. And again, that's just a rough guide as to what accommodation will cost. It depends entirely on the residence hall that you're placed in. Each of the residence halls has a different cost associated to it, depending on the facilities and the size of the rooms, etc. So this is just really giving you a rough guide. But Glasgow as a city is a very affordable place to be. And really you can live quite cheaply, quite reasonably, compared to many other cities, particularly cities in the south of England. In terms of entry requirements, you will have to follow the requirements that are given to you by the EAP programme. So you would apply, first of all, through EAP, who, once you meet their requirements, they would then nominate you to the University of Glasgow. And generally speaking, we're looking for a 3.0 on a 4.0 scale. If you're nominated by the University of California, then we would normally make you an offer, provided that you're meeting those requirements. We offer a functional anatomy course as well. And as you can see from the slide, we do look for a slightly higher GPA for the functional anatomy course. That course is aimed at pre-med or pre-health students and is a hands-on dissection course that is really emulating the first year of an anatomy course at grad school. And so for that course, we're looking for a slightly higher GPA of 3.4 in biology subjects. But any further inquiries that you might have about that, please do get in touch with us and I'll give you all our contact details in a second. As I said, in terms of the application, you do apply, and I'm sure Phoebe and Diane will keep you right on the application process for the University of California system once I finish my presentation. I mentioned accommodation, so it's guaranteed. The accommodation is located around the west end of the city, so it's not all campus based. There are distances involved. It can be anywhere between 15 minutes walk to 30 minutes walk, just depending on where you are allocated to. But another highlight of the accommodation is that included is off-peak gym membership. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. But the gym at the university is well worth taking part in. You're also eligible to, or have access rather, to all the usual student support services at the university, regardless of how long you're with us. So if you're just coming for a semester, you will still have access to all of these services that are listed here, as well as having access to the National Health Service, which will cover you for medical health concerns that you might have. That's only available in Scotland. If you were to travel outside of Scotland to different parts of the UK, then it would be slightly different. But again, EAP office will be able to give you more information on that. I mentioned about our sport facilities. So in the last 4 years, we've had a major refurbishment of our sport facilities on campus. You will have membership if you are staying with us in our university accommodation. And this just gives you a bit of an idea of what is included. So they have all the up-to-date, all the state-of-the-art cardio and training equipment, as well as many, many different group exercise classes. And all of that will be free of charge as part of your accommodation costs. There's also outdoor facilities located about 3 miles away for those of you who are interested in outdoor sporting pursuits such as hockey, field hockey, soccer, tennis, etc. And then we're coming to the end of the presentation. This is just to give you an idea of where we're located and how easy it is to travel to Glasgow. We have our own international airport, and you can see the different distances involved if you're traveling by airplane into Glasgow directly. There's also another international airport in Edinburgh, and I think normally you would fly into Edinburgh initially to have your orientation there and then be transported across to Glasgow for our orientation. So these distances and timings are very similar for flying into Edinburgh as opposed to flying into Glasgow. These are some of our social media links. And I really strongly suggest and encourage you to look at them. We have some fascinating blogs posted by our current student ambassadors who are in Glasgow at present on the WordPress. So you can go there and one of our students who is visiting us from the University of Florida has posted a really informative, really interesting blog about her experiences being in Glasgow at the time of the pandemic. So I really do encourage you to take a look at that. But there's also lots of chat going on in the different channels and lots of really good advice for students who are thinking of coming to Glasgow and who are currently there. And then finally, again, ignore the summer school, but look at the study abroad and exchange programme information at the bottom. So the email address takes you directly to the Global Opportunities team, who will be able to answer all your questions. They are the team that will look after your application and will look after you whilst you're at the University of Glasgow. And you can also view the website, which has a lot more information, giving you links to the course catalogue, where you'll be able to read about all the different courses that we have available and view course specification documents there as well. Okay, finally, just to say thank you. Those are my details on the screen as well. But before you view away, I'm going to, if it's still okay with Phoebe, I'm going to show you a couple of short videos which will showcase the university campus a little bit. One of them is a tour that's conducted by some of our student ambassadors, and the other one is a short video just showcasing the university. So let me see if I can come out of this and I'll find my video links to share those with you. Okay, so this is not as slick as I wanted it to be, but we will get there.
And if anybody has any questions for after the videos, feel free to put them in the chat and we will read them once Colette is done showing us these videos.
Okay. All right, here we go. Okay, can you see this? Is it coming up? There's no sound. Hang on.
Good grammar and spelling are.
Okay, and I'm just going to put up another slide, bear with me.
Hello and welcome to your very own private tour of the University of Glasgow. My name's Shamil, this is Patrick and this is Amy, and today we're going to take you around our campus and show you our favourite parts of our university. So from here you can see quite a lot of the city behind me. We are currently in the west end of the city. The university was founded in 1451 and it's the fourth oldest university in the UK. So Glasgow is Gaelic for Deer Green Place, and we have over 90 parks and gardens. We have a lot of galleries and music venues in the city as well. So we have the SECC, the Hydro, and towards that way you can also go to the city centre, which is just a 10-minute ride on the subway or a short walk as well. So if you follow me through, I'm going to take you into the main building. So this is the East Quad of our university. So it's home to various lecture theatres and offices, but one thing to point out is Bute Hall over there. So that's where you would have exams, graduation, and the ceremony would end in this quadrangle here. That's the tower you're hearing. The tower is a very beautiful part of the university. We have a lot of Hogwarts vibes going on, as you can see with the tree. Also, just while you're here, there's a myth that you cannot step on the grass before you graduate, otherwise you're gonna fail all your exams. Just making sure no one's doing that over there. So if you just follow me through, I'll take you into the cloisters.
You might recognise this place from TV and films such as Outlaw King or Outlander, but my favourite thing about the cloisters is all the exciting events that happen here during Freshers Week. Freshers Week is the first week of university, and it's where you get to do all these crazy exciting events, but also figure out which clubs and societies you want to be part of at the University of Glasgow. There are over 250 societies here at the Uni of Glasgow, ranging from cheese and wine tasting, film watching, debating, rugby, football, tennis, you name it. When I came here, I saw the dance society performing right here in the cloisters, and I thought, yes, that's what I want to be part of, and I've loved that. Here we are in the Memorial Chapel. It's a non-denominational chapel, which means it doesn't actually belong to any faith, so it's open to everyone to use. Big services and concerts are held here at Christmas and Easter, but most excitingly, if you're a student or alumni at the Uni of Glasgow, you can get married here. And look, isn't it gorgeous? Did you know the Uni of Glasgow wasn't always here? It was originally built in the city centre and was moved up to Gilmore Hill. This staircase was moved brick by brick from the city centre campus, along with the statues of the unicorn and lion. Some people say if you pat the unicorn, it gives you good luck for your exams.
Hello? I got it from here. Although these days we all have a mobile phone in our pocket, back in the days this is what we used to make a phone call. These telephone boxes were here for a particular reason. George Gilbert Scott, who was the man who designed the main building, and his grandson, Giles Gilbert Scott, was the person responsible for designing these telephone boxes. As we're walking past the SRC building here, this used to be the men's union, but now it houses the Student Representative Council. They are like the student liaison for everything that we do here on campus. So if you ever have a problem, you can come talk to them here. So behind me is the Quincentennial Gate. It was constructed on the 500th anniversary of the university to commemorate all the amazing people who've walked through the doors here, like Adam Smith, James Watt and Isabel Elder. And if you look closely, you'll notice that there's some gaps on at the gate, and maybe one day your name could be there. So from Amy, Shamil and I, thank you so much for joining us on the tour today, and hopefully see you soon.
Okay. Thank you again for your attention this afternoon. I believe, Phoebe, were you going to take over, or did you want to answer some of the chat, some of the questions on chat?
We do have a few questions in the chat. Mm-hmm. And then thank you all for your patience. After the questions, we just have a couple short slides. But our first question is, I am a pre-med student. Would this mean I have to take the anatomy class before I apply for the program?
I wonder, is that taking the anatomy class at one of the California campuses? We don't have a prerequisite for that class. Other than having taken some biology up to usually around level 2.
I think that this might also be something that for the student who asked this, you may want to reach us after. If necessary, we can put in touch with your campus advisor or an academic specialist to discuss the courses in more detail. And then this one, Colette, I think you can speak to, is there an option to have accommodation off campus? If so, would it be less expensive than to live in the accommodations provided by the university?
Yes, I can answer that. It is, it's not mandatory, certainly from the University of Glasgow, for you to stay in our accommodation. I'm not sure, I don't think it's mandatory from the EAP programme, but again, you can perhaps mention that. And I see that Hilary is actually online, so perhaps Hilary might be able to answer that. But also, just in terms of living off campus, it can absolutely be less expensive. But what we have found through experience is that because students are coming for 6 months or a year, it's a little bit more tricky to find a rental situation or a rental property for a shorter period. And it's more difficult to try and secure that if you're not in country. So really what we find is that most students prefer just going into university accommodation because it's so much less problematic and stressful.
Okay, thank you. Next question. You mentioned attractions around the university and distance from other countries. How often will we be able to leave the uni to visit these sites, and for how long? Would a weekend away be acceptable?
Yes, I should say. we have many, many students on the exchange programme who travel at weekends very easily. Because of where Glasgow is located, it's very easy to reach other parts of Europe by airplane. And so a weekend trip is usually quite an exciting and attractive option. I should just briefly mention, and I don't want to get into any kind of big detail, we are obviously leaving the European Union as a nation, and it won't impact on American citizens or citizens of other countries as such, because your visa will be the same regardless. But what it may mean is that travel prices to go to other European countries may increase, where at the moment there's lots of really budget flights and budget travel, we may see an increase in that as a result of the UK leaving the European Union. So by the time that students are coming to Glasgow, i.e. from September 2021, that will be very much the situation.
Okay, thank you. Let's see. Oh, this one is from Hillary, who is at the Scotland Study Centre.
Yes.
Colette, thank you so much for the fantastic presentation. Is the service learning course still an option? And if so, could you explain a little bit about it, please?
Yes, sure. I'd be happy to explain it. So we do offer a service learning programme or service learning course. It is a 20 credit option at the University of Glasgow, and it runs in the fall semester only. I believe it's the fall. I'll double check that. I think it's the fall. What it entails is students will participate in a service learning experience, so usually based in a charitable organisation somewhere in and around Glasgow. And then in addition to that would normally be for up to 10 hours per week. And then in addition to that, they will spend an hour to 2 hours in a lecture or tutorial setting where they are reflecting on the experience that they've had in the service learning setting. And the assessment is usually based on that reflective journal and at the end of the course. Normally, or in the past, students would be, the placement itself would be facilitated by the coordinator of the programme. However, I think now, in order to offer more flexibility, students are encouraged to find their own placement with help from the coordinator. So there is a bit of work that needs to be done in advance if anybody is interested in participating in the service learning course. And what I would say is that it would be worth flagging that to the EAP team before you arrive, well before you arrive in Glasgow, and ensuring that those communications are taking place in advance of any study period taking place, because there may be some additional work involved in setting everything up for you. I should also say that in order to participate in the service learning course, you need to have a certain type of visa. Ordinarily, it would be called a Tier 4 visa, but we're actually just that the UK Visa and Immigration Service is about to introduce new different visas. So I'm not sure, I think it's just called, I don't even know what it's called. I think it's just called a student visa. But again, we will work with EAP to update them on the process that's required for that. But that new visa comes into play in December of this year. Hope that's answered that question.
I think so. We just have a couple more that I see in the chat. And for any of you, if you didn't get your questions answered, we also have our email addresses should be in the chat as well. So please feel free to follow up with us. And we'd be happy to speak with you one-on-one or even schedule a Zoom to discuss this further. We have a question. How competitive is it to get into the program?
So I'm not sure, Phoebe, whether that's something that would be, I've had this question before from another fair for another partner. And in terms of, I suppose, in terms of Glasgow, if you're nominated by the EAP program, then we would normally accept you if you're meeting our requirements. But I guess from your side of things, Phoebe, it's whether it's, I guess it would be relating to how many applications you're getting.
Right.
Yeah, and in how many, because there are obviously, there are there's a certain amount of spaces that are available at the University of Glasgow. So would you be able to say a little bit about that?
Yeah, so as you all will see in the following slides that I have, it'll talk a little bit about, obviously you need to be in a certain class standing, you need a certain GPA. But the good thing about this being part of Scottish universities is that there are three universities that are available as part of this program. So we do try to accommodate everybody's first choice. Most of the time we're able to do that, but if anything is impacted, if there is a major that may be better suited at a different one of the three universities than your first choice, we do work with you. So there is some more flexibility in terms of getting everyone who's eligible for this program to be able to attend because we have the three universities to choose from. University of Glasgow is a great choice and students really love it. It also does not, for whatever reason, I don't think it tends to fill up, at least it hasn't in previous years. Of course, every year could be different, but yeah. Diane, do you have anything else to say about that?
I would add that if the students meet the requirements, then you'll get in, just like what Colette said. So it's, if you have the 3.0 and you meet all the other requirements, then you will be in the program. What's important to note is for different departments, the GPA requirement might be different. So for example, the pre-med, as Colette mentioned, and there is a question regarding that for the pre-med question, she was referring about the 3.4 GPA. So for that particular department, if you want to go to the University of Glasgow and you know that you want to take pre-med, you need the 3.4 GPA, not the 3.0. But if you know you're going to be in other departments, then you just need the 3.0. Okay. So we can go on to the other questions. Hopefully that responds to that. There are a few more questions.
There is a question. I hope I'm not missing any. Oh, there is, how many hours per week does a student engage in the service experience? I think that was a follow-up to the service learning.
Mm-hmm. So it can be anything between, I think it's usually up to around 9 or 10 hours per week actually in the service experience, and then another further hour to 2 hours in the classroom setting.
Okay, thank you. Let's see, we have a few more. I haven't heard anything in regards to the summer physics program. Is that the same info as for the semester program? So no, this presentation was talking specifically about the semester program. Diane, do we have anything planned in regards to webinars
Yes, we will be doing webinars on the summer programs and the summer physics programs, probably in February 2021. But this particular webinar is focused on the fall, spring, and year-long programs at the University of Glasgow.
And then a couple of final questions. We'll answer these last three, and then for the rest of you, again, please feel free to email us. So what are the theater and arts programs like at Glasgow compared to the other schools in Scotland?
Do you want me to answer that? Well, I can try.
if possible.
I can certainly talk about the programs at Glasgow University, at University of Glasgow. The theatre program that we offer is it's probably more theoretical than practical theatre skills. In terms of there isn't a huge amount of performance, if any, in the theatre course at Glasgow. So much of it is the theoretical, with some practical skills, but those courses are often a little bit more limited in their access. So they are usually reserved for our degree seeking students. But every year we're usually successful in securing maybe a couple of spots on those practical courses. So it really is a matter of engaging in advance with the EAP program, who in turn will talk to us about it, so that we can alert or we can let you know what is available in that coming semester. In terms of the arts programs in general, so we call it the College of Art. It has many, many courses and many subject areas within the College of Arts. And those are traditionally they are very popular courses amongst our visiting students. The format of the course is lecture-based, with tutorials, face-to-face tutorials, and usually face-to-face lectures. And there's a lot of interaction between the students themselves and also between students and academic staff. That's a very traditional way of teaching, which will be replicated at the other Scottish universities. So that will not really differ. And the content of the courses, it will differ, of course, because there will be different people teaching it at the different universities. But, you know, generally speaking, I'm not actually sure what the third university in Scotland is. I know this one of them is Edinburgh, but I don't know who the third one is. St Andrews. Okay, so, you know, they're all very similar, very high quality universities. Therefore, the experiences are going to be very similar.
We do have a follow-up from our study center saying that Glasgow is actually the best option for theater, as the options are more limited elsewhere. Let's see, we have a couple more. Does Glasgow fill up more for the summer physics program than the 6 or 12 month study abroad sessions? The answer to that would be yes. There are stricter caps on our summer physics programs, and we can speak more to that in the upcoming webinar that we should be having, as Diane said, probably around February. And the final question that we have, and thank you everyone for your patience and for your great questions. The final question is, how many classes can we take? And we have, you're required to take a full-time course of study while you are abroad. So that ends up shaking out to 3 to 6 courses, which is equivalent to 21 to 24 UC quarter units or 14 to 16 UC semester units. So you are taking a full course load when you're there. I would like to thank Colette so much. Thank you for your answering, your helpful answers to the questions and the excellent presentation. My name is Phoebe Light. I am a program advisor at UCEAP. I'm joined by, can you repeat the course number unit? So yes, 3 to 6 courses. That's 21 to 24 quarter units or 14 to 16 semester units. And that's UC units. Anyway, like I was saying, my name is Phoebe. I'm the program advisor. I'm joined by Diane, who is the program specialist. We've been here with you on this presentation today. And we just have, to close things out, just a couple of slides to show you with some information about UCEAP and some application deadlines for this program. So if you could just hang out with us for a couple more minutes, we will show you these slides and feel free to take screenshots of any information that you would find useful. Let me just share my screen. Okay, so everybody see the slideshow? So why choose UCEAP? Our programs are designed for UC students and constantly evolve based on specific UC student needs.
You can't see it, Phoebe.
Oh, you can't see it?
No.
Oh, no. Sorry about that. One second. Can you see it now?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. So our programs are designed for UC student needs. Your enrollment continues while you're abroad. So your tuition will not be paid at another university. Your courses will be on your transcript, just like UC courses would be. It's a very seamless transition to studying abroad and coming back. Your financial aid goes with you, as do your scholarships and grants and loans. These can all be used to pay for UCEAP study abroad programs. And all the courses that you take abroad will receive UC credit and appear on your UC transcript. In this slide, this just shows some basic requirements for Scottish universities at a glance. As we spoke about earlier, the basic minimum GPA is a 3.0, but keep in mind that that GPA can vary from major to major. So for example, the medical or the pre-med major would need a 3.4. So please feel free to take a screenshot of this. And I will move on to the next slide. So next steps, if you have not applied or finished applying, explore our website, visit your campus study abroad office for information on application steps and deadlines. Start an application by selecting the Apply Now button on the UCEAP website. And finally, make sure you have a valid passport. This particular step, making sure you have a valid passport, may take longer right now due to COVID. So if you don't have a valid passport, I definitely would strongly suggest that you get that process started now. And finally, deadlines vary campus to campus. So for applications, so please feel free to take a screenshot of this. It also includes the email addresses for each campus's study abroad office, and your campus advisors will be able to help you more in regards to these deadlines or questions that you have regarding the application process. All right. So
thank you everyone for attending. And please follow up if you have any questions or comments. Thank you, Colette, for your presentation.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. It's good to talk to you all.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.